Fourth Estate presents The Complete Blood, Sweat and Tea, written by Tom Reynolds, read by Daniel Philpott.
Prologue.
Too young.
Yesterday started well. We had the only new yellow vehicle on the complex, and it really is an improvement on the old motors. But then we got a job that should have been routine, but unfortunately was not. We were given a 34-year-old male seizure at a nearby football pitch in the middle of a park. Also leaving from our station was the FRU, a fast car designed to get to a scene before the ambulance. As we had a new motor, we were able to keep up with the FRU. Arriving at the top of the street, we were met and directed by some of the patient's football teammates. Unfortunately, the patient was 200 yards into the park, and there was no way we were going to get the ambulance onto the field. The council had built a little moat around the park to stop joyriders tearing up the grass in their stolen cars. The FRU paramedic had reached the patient first, and I ran across the field to get to the patient as the paramedic looked worried. And this isn't someone who normally worries. As I reached the patient, carrying the scoop, which we would use to move him, the paramedic asked me if I thought the patient was breathing. The patient was Nigerian, and it is not racist to say that sometimes detecting signs of life on a black person is harder than if the patient is Caucasian. White people tend to look dead. Black people often just look unconscious. Also, a windy playing field at dusk is not the ideal circumstance to assess a patient. "He's not breathing," I told the paramedic, just as my crewmate reached us. "Shit," replied the paramedic. "I left the FR2 in my car." An FR2 is a defibrillation machine which is used to shock a heart back into a normal rhythm. In the UK, emergency medical technicians, EMTs, are allowed to use this piece of equipment, and rapid defib shocks are essential in certain forms of cardiac arrest. I had to run 200 yards back to our ambulance to get this now vital piece of kit. On my return, my colleagues had started to bag the patient. This means using equipment to breathe for the patient and performing cardiopulmonary resuscitation, or CPR, which is the procedure to keep blood flowing around the body in the absence of a pulse. Attaching the defib pads, I saw that the patient was in fine VF, ventricular fibrillation. This is a heart rhythm, which means the heart is quivering rather than pumping blood around the body to the brain and other vital organs. Technically, the patient is dead, and without immediate treatment, they will remain dead. We shocked the patient once, and his heart rhythm changed. It changed to a systole. This means that the heart is not moving at all, and it is much more difficult to restore life to the patient with this form of rhythm. We decided to scoop and run to the nearest hospital. The paramedic secured the patient's airway by passing a tube down the windpipe, and we got the patient onto the scoop, all the time continuing the CPR and giving potentially life-saving drugs. We then carried him, with the help of his teammates, to the ambulance and rushed him to hospital. Unfortunately, the patient never regained consciousness and died in the resuscitation room. 34 years old, normally fit and healthy, and he drops dead on a football pitch. Despite our best efforts, there was nothing more we could have done for him. The treatment went according to plan, and the resuscitation attempt went smoothly. This was a proper job, but one job we would have happily done without. Blood, sweat, and tea. Why won't they let me do this? Here is a moan about something that I am not allowed to do. I'm not allowed to run people over in my job. I could really clear the streets of a lot of stupid people if I was able to do that. Picture the scene. There I am, driving through the streets of London in a big white van, with blue flashing lights, loud sirens, running, and the word ambulance written in rather large letters. As a pedestrian, what would you do? Would you think, Being run over by that would really hurt. I think I'll wait the 12 nanoseconds that it takes him to drive past before I cross the road. Or would you, as most of the people in my area apparently do, think, an ambulance on his way to an important job. I bet I can run across the road in front of him before he can hit me. During the last job, 3 people tried to dive under my ambulance. If I was allowed, by government grant or some such, to keep driving and splat them across my windscreen, that would mean 3 less idiots being allowed to breed tonight. Oh well, I might get lucky later tonight. Dear Mr. Alcoholic, can all alcoholics please just get drunk in their houses and fall asleep there? Why do you insist that you drink your tenant's super in a public place where some do-gooder will think you are ill and call for an ambulance? Can you also have a bath once in a while? I know it's nice to roll around in the road while drunk, but it would be nice if you were at least a bit clean to start with. Would you mind awfully not swearing at me, taking a swing at me, or exposing yourself to me? I have quite enough abuse from the non-drunks out there. Still, at least your fists are easy to dodge, and if I stop holding you up, you fall over. If you have a medical condition, please don't use it as an excuse to get taken into hospital. If you tell me I'm drunk and need to sleep it off, I have less work to do than if you tell me that you have a chest pain, angina, cancer, and difficulty in breathing. The more tests I have to do, the longer it will be before you get to hospital, and the more I have to come into physical contact with you. If you are just drunk, then I can just be a taxi. When you have been sick, at some point in the next week or so, could you please change your clothing? Give them to someone who hasn't knackered their brain on booze to wash. Dry vomit on clothing while advertising your love for beer doesn't endear you to me, thank you very much. Please keep your weight down, either through diet or through terminal liver failure. I'm the poor bastard that has to lug the dead weight of your unconscious body into the ambulance. You don't have to tell me I'm an alcoholic and sound so proud about it. I do have a nose and can smell for myself. Finally, although Tennant's Super Strong Lager, White Lightning, and for the rare rich alcoholic Stella Artois are perfectly acceptable drinks, could you please come up with something less damaging? I think lighter fuel is better for you and contains fewer chemicals. A child is born. The story of the first baby I delivered. I can still remember it now. I can also remember my feeling of relief when it all went smoothly, yet still managed to turn it into a rant about midwifery. Just in from my late shift and feeling more upbeat than normal. Tonight, I delivered my first baby. And yet I can still turn this happy event into a rant. Picture the scene. You are a midwife. This means you have a chip on your shoulder the size of the African debt. And a lady comes into your maternity department in the second stage of labour. Do you, A, say hello, take a room and we'll have that baby out as soon as we can? Or, B, tell them to go home and come back when the pain gets worse? Guess which answer results in your baby being delivered by an ambulance bloke who has one day's training in maternity and who, to be honest, slept through most of it. Then when I take mother and baby into the same maternity department, are you A, vaguely apologetic, or B, snotty towards the ambulance crew who did your work for you? Can you guess that tonight I got B for both questions? Otherwise, it was a nice simple delivery, with Dad shooting pictures on his mobile phone, sending them to all and sundry, while his wife was lying bloodstained and naked on a leather sofa. Blood went all over that sofa, which come summer will start to smell just a little rank. Blood also went all over me. Note to self, must remember to pack Wellington boots next time. And my acting skills, don't worry Mum, all normal, I've done hundreds of deliveries, were tested to the limit. And I didn't have to pick up any alcoholics. Why would people even think it? I have sometimes been astounded by the bloody-mindedness of people, and sometimes by their stupidity. Now I am astonished at their petty nastiness. I'm driving my big white van with blue flashing lights and a siren to a one-year-old child with difficulty in breathing. While passing a group of youths on the pavement, one of them thinks that it would be a good idea to throw his bottle of Coke at the ambulance, thus spraying my screen, obscuring my vision, and nearly causing me to swerve into oncoming traffic. All I can say is that it is lucky for them that I was going to a call, because if I hadn't, I'd have shoved my boot up their arse. Where in the tiny recesses of their minds does it seem like a good idea to throw something at an ambulance running on lights and sirens? All I hope is that one day they need me, something likely given the amount of people like that who get stabbed in my neck of the woods, and I'm just that little too slow to save their worthless skins. Payment point. I get called to a lot of RTAs, that is, for the uninformed, road traffic accidents. I'd say that 90% of these are diagnosed as whiplash, which is a muscular sprain of the neck. This is a minor injury that is treated with painkillers. I'd suggest that over half of these are an attempt to gain insurance money. In the ambulance trade, we call this the payment point, referring to the point in the neck that is painful and pays out the money. Tonight, I saw the most blatant attempt to get money from an accident. I was called to a flyover where two cars had been in a near collision. Yes, a near collision. There was no damage to either vehicle. Neither were there any skid marks on the road. The patient was the passenger of the car and complained of pain on the right side of his neck. He was desperate to go to hospital. What reason, I did not know, as there was obviously no injury. This was made even more evident when he forgot what side of his neck the pain was on. When I called him on this, he pretended not to know what I was talking about. Even the police were not above making fun of this idiot. It probably didn't help that he was 10 years younger than me and cruising around in a red sports car. Of course, RTA is now RTC, Road Traffic Collision, because if it's an accident, then the police can't prosecute anyone. Single. Although I do love my job dearly, there are a number of disadvantages. At the moment, I am a relief worker, which means although I have a main station, I can be sent anywhere in London to cover absences and holidays in the core staff. I also don't have a regular crewmate. I am essentially the whore of the London Ambulance Service. So at the moment, I am sitting on my backside at my main station with no one to work with, watching daytime TV. Bored, 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 bored. Of course, at some point in the next 12 hours, I could be rushing off anywhere in London. Being on strange stations is actually quite good fun, as you get to meet new people and, let's face it, in this job, moving around London just means same shit, different scenery. But at the moment, I'm bored. Daytime TV. The ambulance relief's worst enemy. Thankfully, I'm no longer a relief. I'm core staff now, which means I have a regular partner and I work mainly out of one station. Some people just can't wait. So, there I am in my ambulance helping a bloke who was actually quite ill, when all of a sudden the back doors fly open and some idiot decides to start berating me because I'm blocking the road. Needless to say, I am not pleased at this. Not only because it is embarrassing for the patient, but also because of the sheer bloody cheek of this person. When I tell her, very politely mind you, to bugger off, she replies with the old favourite, "I'm a taxpayer and I pay your wages." At this I remind her that my patient, my crewmate and I also pay taxes. At this, she's a bit nonplussed. Yet still, she continues to moan that there is no need for me to block the road. In any event, I did need to block the road. I don't do it on purpose, but it is more important to get to the patient quickly. This woman's moaning then gets other drivers upset and they start honking their horns. and the only way I'd get rid of the woman who was in such a hurry was to pull the door shut after me and tell her to imagine her relative in the ambulance.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.